Good afternoon, everyone. Good evening, Dr. Devor. Welcome to Repository for Remembering. This is a talk by Dr. Devor, the Chair in Transgender Studies of the University of Victoria in British Columbia, Canada. This talk is part of the public programs for MCAD Commons, Artists Film International Care. This is also our way of addressing one of the issues in the Philippines, which is the lack of archives, and therefore also a lack of understanding of what transgender is, and also more studies on that. I'd like to give a brief introduction of Dr. Aaron Devor. He has been studying and teaching about transgender topics for more than 30 years, an author of numerous well-cited scholarly articles and widely acclaimed books. His most recent one, The Transgender Archives, Foundation for the Future, published in 2014, was a Lambda Literary Awards finalist in LGBT nonfiction. A trans man, is the founder and subject matter expert of the world's largest transgender archives. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Devor.
Thank you very much. I appreciate you coming to this talk, and I will be going through a number of slides. It's a small group. If you have questions, please feel free to either raise your hand using the Zoom function or put a message in the chat. I'll watch the chat if there are comments. The image that you see on your screen right now is the building that the Transgender Archives is in at the University of Victoria. That is our library, our main library called the McPherson Library. And as you can see, the Transgender Archives is now 10 years old. Sorry, we'll just start at the beginning. So for those of you who are not familiar where University of Victoria or Victoria is, I thought I'd start with just a little map. We're just across the water. And so we're on a small island quite a large island off the edge of the continent of North America. Just a northwest corner above the United States. So there we are. It's the next stop just across the water. And the University of Victoria sits on the traditional territory of the indigenous people called the Wakongan speaking people. And we always start our talks at the University of Victoria by acknowledging with respect the traditional territories of the Songhees, Esquimalt, and Wasanich peoples who have lived here for time immemorial. So I'll start with a question, why do we need archives? Answering that question from a couple of well-known authors, at least in this part of the world, George Orwell, you may have heard of him. And he says the most effective way to destroy people is to deny and obliterate their own understanding of their history. And the history of transgender people is not really yet written. We're just beginning to be able to write that history. And archives are the raw material that historians use to write history from. And so we need a history. And then I've also like another quote here from Confucius, who says, study the past if you were to define the future. And the past is what we find in the archives, and the future that we would like to define for transgender people, we hope to be better than the past, because past has not been so great for transgender people. I'd also draw your attention to this statement, which is called the Universal Declaration on Archives. It's put out by the International Council on Archives. And again, in answer to the question of why do we need archives, the Universal Declaration says archives are a unique and irreplaceable heritage passed from one generation to another. Archives are managed to preserve their value and meaning, and they play an essential role in the development of societies by safeguarding and contributing to individual and community memory. Open access to archives enriches our knowledge of human society, promotes democracy, protects citizens' rights, and enhances the quality of life. So I think those are good reasons for having archives. And I'd now like to show you a brief video that gives you a little bit of a feeling and a little bit of a taste of the transgender archives. It's important for any people to know their history if they're going to have pride in who they are and to feel a sense of dignity. So the Transgender Archives serves as a repository of the history of transgender activism and research.
So important to have spaces like this accessible and open to the public. There is a real lack of intergenerational memory, so places like this are really important for people to have somewhere to come and look and find and get engaged and work with the material, because that's what really brings it to life.
It is amazing, and I'm totally devastated that I'm not here longer. I will definitely be back.
It's a beautiful location. The collection itself is amazing.
It's been incredible. It's one of the fastest archives I've ever been at.
I'm really enchanted with how friendly and supportive people are here.
The Transgender Archives are one of the defining collections of the University of Victoria Libraries and a foundational collection for the future of transgender studies.
A little bit more about the Transgender Archives. I think it's important to understand that this is a government-funded public university. And what that means is that there is free public access to everything in the Transgender Archives. We started collecting in 2007 and officially launched 10 years ago in late 2011 at the World Professional Association for Transgender Health meetings. That organization, if you're not familiar with it, is usually just referred to as WPATH. It is the largest association of people who have an interest and study and work with, and many of whom are transgender people. And their meetings have like 1,000 people at them, so they're quite a large organization. When archivists try and discuss how big is an archives, the most common measurement that's used is if you took all the books and all the boxes that things are kept in, banker's boxes about 12 inches in length, or I don't know how many centimeters that is exactly, 30 centimeters or so in width, actually. And you took all the objects, you put them on one long shelf, how long would that shelf be? And our shelf would be 160 linear meters or 530 linear feet, and which is about the length of 1.5 football fields. So most people, when I say to them, this is the largest trans archive in the world, they don't think that big, because they think, how much stuff could there be about transgender people? And so this is just the tip of the iceberg. There's lots more. We're still very actively collecting, but there's a lot of material in there. As you saw in the video, it went by fairly quickly. The research records begin in the late 19th century, and we mark the point where we're collecting as the point where researchers started to use the word trans or transgender. In that case, it was transvestite was the word that was first used, and where they first start to say, there is something going on here other than just homosexuality. And so that started to happen at the end of the 19th century. Our records of trans activism begin in 1960. The first self-consciously trans activism, where people said, we identify as some kind of trans and we feel we deserve rights and respect, actually started in Berlin, Germany in the 20s and 30s. There was some activism then, people who identified themselves as transvestites, people who wore clothing, vestite coming from the Latin for clothing, who wore clothing of the sex that was not expected of them. That activism was very harshly closed down by the Nazis in the 1930s. And if you have seen photographs of Nazi book burnings, they're black and white photographs. The books that they were burning were mostly books from the Institute for Sexual Science that was run by Magnus Hirschfeld, which is the first place that trans surgeries took place and where trans people were supported in their wish to live as they wish to live. So that was closed down by the Nazis in the 1930s. Activism, people who identified as trans, again, transvestites in this case, started again in the late 1950s, early 1960s in the United States of America. And our records go back to 1960, so pretty much the beginning of that resurgence of trans activism. As you saw go by, again, rather quickly in the video, we have material from 23 countries in 15 languages. It comes from all continents except Antarctica. And I've put a list of the countries represented in our collections at the bottom of the screen. And as I talk, you'll see a few examples around the edge of the screen of some of the materials that we have from different parts of the world. And down the right-hand side, there's one from Spain, there's one from Japan. Along the bottom is some minutes from a meeting of the Harry Benjamin Foundation, Harry Benjamin being the person who wrote the first book-length study of trans people called The Transsexual Phenomenon. That was published in 1966. So what's in that football field and a half of archives is a great variety of different kinds of materials. And again, you'll see some examples around the edges of the screen. We have books, many, many books. We have newsletters and magazines. We have fiction, pamphlets from organizations of various kinds, organizational records such as minutes of meetings and correspondence, personal papers of some key activists. We have newspaper clipping files on the bottom of the screen in the center is one of my favorites, which is in the Yiddish language. And it is announcing the opening of the first gender clinic in North America. We have records of some key court cases. We have audio recordings on a number of different media. We have movies, again, and different versions of them, beta, VHS, DVDs. We've got a large collection of photographs. We have a fair sized collection of erotica, original artwork, such as the image in the lower right-hand corner, and ephemera, which not everybody's familiar with that word, so I'll just take a moment. Those are materials or things that were created that when they were created, the people that created them did not have any expectation that they would last. They were meant to be transitory materials. And so I've got two buttons up on the screen here, one that says gender defender and one that says gender identity is not sexual identity. So those are kind of buttons that you would wear on your shirt or your jacket, and the people that created them didn't expect them to last long, but that's part of our ephemera, and we have a lot of materials like that as well. So I thought I would give you a little bit of the story of how the Transgender Archives came to be, because it has a lot to do with trust and caring, and I think that that's part of the theme that my talk is part of. So it started over lunch, and it started over lunch with Ricky Swin, who you see on the screen at the right-hand side. And Ricky Swin she's still alive, is a wealthy individual who is trans, and wanted to put some of her money to a good cause, and she opened something called the Ricky Swin Institute. It was devoted to gender education, research, and there was also a library and an archive. Now, she founded that and funded it with her own money. It cost approximately $3.5 million to set this place up, so it was a very nice institute. The mission was to stimulate changes in our culture to improve the understanding and acceptance of trans persons. It opened in March 2001, and it closed in December of 2004. So it did not work out the way Ricky had planned. It was not really what she had in mind. She lived for a while in Victoria, the city that I am in now. And in the summer of 2005, we were sitting over lunch, and I asked her, "Ricky, what happened to the Ricky Swin Institute?" And she explained to me that it hadn't worked out the way she had planned, and she had simply closed the door. And it was all sitting there on the top floor of a building in Chicago that she actually owned the building, so she could just close the door. And she said that she was thinking about moving it to Victoria. And so I said, "Ricky, would you consider moving it to the University of Victoria?" And she said she would consider that. We entered into discussions, and by 2007, it came to the University of Victoria. That was our first collection. So in that were extensive newsletters and other periodicals. There are over 400 newsletter titles, documents from an organization called Fantasia Fair, which I'll tell you a little bit more about in a few moments, and documents from the International Foundation of Gender Education, a large and important trans activist organization of its day, and collections from two key individuals who were trans activists and leaders in the community, Ariadne Kane and Virginia Prince. And a large collection of photos, audio and video tapes, and books. This collection was just the Ricky Swin collection, or Ricky Swin Institute collection. We did not yet believe that we had a transgender archives. And what moved us from a single collection to a transgender archives had a lot to do with relationships and trusting relationships that I had with other people. So key to building the archives were relationships that are built on trust over time, that were the result of a lot of networking and knowing of people. So trust, one definition of trust is rapport plus integrity, right? And I put on the screen one of my favorite comments about integrity, and it's doing the right thing even when no one is watching. So how did we build, how did I and people I worked with build rapport and integrity and trust? So collectors, there are people out there who had collections. I knew there were people out there who had collections, and they had been collecting, some of the people that eventually have donated to the Transgender Archives at the University of Victoria had been collecting materials for decades, many decades. And they really cherished those very valuable collections, and were not about to put them anywhere that they didn't feel like they were going to be properly cared for. And that's a lot of the reason they had held them for decades, is because there wasn't any place that they felt they could trust to place them. But they will put their cherished valuables somewhere if they do trust us. So what is involved in the trust? First of all, they have to feel that the content will be properly understood and will be properly appreciated. In addition, they have to feel that there is secure and professional archival physical storage. It's going to be appreciated, but it also the people who are receiving it have the capacity to take proper care of it. In our case, we have an institution, and that institution had to make a commitment and have the capability to take care of these materials. And for the collectors that I was dealing with, community access was very important. And as I mentioned before, our collections are open to the public at no charge. Now, the founder, that's me, had well-established trust with key people. And there is a number of different elements of who those key people are. So first of all, senior trans activists were people that I had known, as was mentioned in the intro. I've been working in this field myself for many decades. And so I knew a lot of the senior activists who had been also active for decades. We had worked together and we had some level of understanding and trust already. Also, because I'm a researcher, knew all the leading researchers. So I mentioned before that our collections are research and activism are the two main places that we focus. And I had long-standing relationships with researchers as well. And I knew some of the collectors of the trans historical records. And also, very importantly, I had good, strong relationships with key senior staff at the University of Victoria, because if the University of Victoria was going to make an institutional commitment, then key staff had to stand behind that commitment. And so how did these relationships build? I showed you at the beginning a map of where Victoria is. Now you can see an aerial view of some of, not the entire University of Victoria, but there you can see a kind of a circular image. That's, we call that the Ring Road. A lot of the university is within that circle, but there's a lot more spread out around it. And you can see we're on, right on the edge of the ocean. It's a very beautiful location here at the University of Victoria. I invite you all to come and visit whenever you can. So, in terms of my relationship with the University of Victoria, I have been here for a long time, and I had a high profile at the University of Victoria. People knew me here. I have been doing this trans research and public education about trans topics for a long time, and that made me well established. I was also have a reputation as a national, local at the university, also a national award winning teacher. And so that also gives me a high profile at the university in particular. I was also for 10 years, which was just coming to an end at the time that I was starting the Transgender Archives, I was for 10 years the dean of all the graduate programs at the University of Victoria. And that came to an end because we have a legislated maximum term limit as the dean. And so I ran the full term and then I was required to step down, and the Transgender Archives was something I started just as I was finishing that. But very high profile position. I'm in everybody's departments and everybody's students. And I also had a long-term reputation as working for equity and strong relationship with the head librarians. There's been a few of them over the years that the Transgender Archives has been in existence. And because of my position as a dean for 10 years, I had strong relationships with all the key decision makers at the University of Victoria. So, you know, relationships are core to being able to make things happen and to be able to have the trust that is necessary to be able to make things happen. So I also had strong relationships with researchers and activists, which is, again, core to people trusting the University of Victoria as the repository for the things that they really care about that mean a great deal to them. So I was well known in the research community. I have been a member of the WPATH, I mentioned before, the World Professional Association for Transgender Health, since 1992. So it's getting to be a number of years. I've been on the Standards of Care Committee since 1999. The most public aspect of the WPATH organization is they publish an internationally used standards of care that apply to the medical care and the psychological care of transgender people who are transitioning. That's quite a high profile document. I'm also in charge of, I do the liaison with people who are translating it into world languages. It's now in 17 languages. So that gives you an idea of how widely used it is. I'm also the official historian of the WPATH organization and author of many well-read and well-cited publications. I've done lectures, keynote and plenary addresses around the world. Also, so well-known in the research community, that helps make the trust that we need to get researchers to be willing to put their materials in our care. Also well-known in the trans community, I was the author of two foundational books. I've just put them up on the screen. Those are the two that are the most well-known and were early publications that help build the area of transgender studies. I had attended and also lectured at many, many community events at this point around the world, but mostly in North America. I was somewhat known for uncovering the story of Reed Erickson, who I will talk about a little bit more in a couple of minutes, and personal friends with many of the senior activists. Now, since starting the Transgender Archives, I've also built rapport and built trust by founding the Moving Trans History Forward conferences, which are international conferences, and founding and being the inaugural chair of transgender studies here at the University of Victoria. And that is the only chair in the world. When I started it, there's now another one at the University of Buenos Aires in Argentina, I'm very pleased to say. Okay, so what is in the Transgender Archives in a little more detail? The major collections are the Ricky Swin Institute collection. That was the first one. In that are Fantasia Fair documents, the Ariadne Kane collection, International Foundation for Gender Education collection, and the Virginia Prince collection, which I mentioned before. Other core collection is about Reed Erickson and the Erickson Educational Foundation. There is also a very large collection from the University of Ulster, who had their own transgender archive and was probably the largest one before we started ours, but it's now moved and joined ours, and the Ian Amaracal collection. There are many, many other things in the Transgender Archive, many, many other collections, but those are kind of the biggest ones and the ones I'm going to highlight for you today. So I have to stop for a moment and say, I've just told you what the major collections are. Here's pictures of the people who are behind those collections. And there are some really big gaps in what we have. So what you'll see here is that most of the people on the screen are trans feminine people. Almost everybody is white. You may not be able to pick out. Ian Amaracal is an Indigenous person, Two-Spirit person from North American Indigenous. And Richard Eakins is a researcher, and I'm not sure what his gender is, but I think he's cisgender. He's not transmasculine, I know that for sure. So there's some folks missing. There's almost nobody of, no people of color. There are some, but not many. There's only one showing on this screen, but in the collection, there is representation of people of color, but not a lot. Transmasculine people are underrepresented. And what this is about is that in order to be a trans person who creates a record of your life, who has the resources to collect records from your life and other people's lives, who is able to hang on to them, has some place to store them, has housing stability enough to hold on to them for decades, and then is financially well enough off to be able to donate them to the Transgender Archives. Well, that's a very narrow slice of humanity. And so there's a lot of people for all sorts of social structural reasons, never was able to create records, was not able to retain them if they did create them, and certainly was not able to donate them. So we are attempting to fill some of those gaps. I just want to say that I'm aware that those gaps are there, and they reflect the reality of who is able to produce and retain and donate to the Transgender Archives. We do not have a purchasing budget, so we rely on donations. We do help with the cost of transportation, but there is no budget to buy collections at this time. So just a few minutes on some of these more major collections that we do have. Fantasia Fair is a week-long trans event that takes place every October in Provincetown, Massachusetts. If you're at all familiar with the map of the United States, Provincetown is in the northeast corner of the United States, and there's a little piece of land that comes out and makes a curlicue, and it's right on the tip of that. So that happens every October, and it has been running since 1974. As far as we know, it is the oldest and longest running trans event in this part of the world. And we have records of the fair from 1974 to 2001. They keep promising us that we'll get the records since 2001. I don't have them yet, but we have the very early records. So this is kind of a unique event. And we have extensive records of this event. Another important piece of our collections is about the International Foundation for Gender Education, most commonly known as the IFGE. It was founded by Marissa Cheryl Lynn, and it sponsored large conventions between 1987 and 2010. And they were a very, very important feature of the trans community during that period of time. There were not a lot of conventions or taking place in that period of time. And they were the ones, there were others, but there were not a lot of them. So this was an important aspect of what they did. And another important aspect of what they did is they published this magazine called Tapestry. I've put an image up on the screen. That ran from 1979 to 2009. So it was long running. It went through many different iterations. The version you see there is the most sophisticated version of it. And it had a very large reach. And this was a magazine that you might stumble upon in a magazine rack along with general interest magazines. And many people have said to me, they thought they were the only trans person in the world. They never met anybody else. They didn't know how to find anybody else. And then one day they stumbled upon this magazine in a magazine rack among general interest magazines, and their lives changed. So it was a very important service to the community. Part of the IFGE collection is some materials from Betty Ann Lind, and you can see her portrait there. That's a original pastel drawing that is part of our art collection. And she was an original board member and served through the early 1990s. And she was also involved with the Fantasia Fair and was a fair coordinator for a number of years. Another key collection is a collection from Virginia Prince. You can see from the dates at the top of the slide that Virginia Prince had quite a long life. And she was, by many people's accounts, a founder of modern transgender activism. And when I said that our transgender activism collection start in 1960, I'm referring to materials we have from Virginia Prince. So she accidentally became the face of public face of cross-dressing in the United States. I say accidentally because how it happened was in 1961, she had a pen pal. Now, not everybody today knows what a pen pal means, so I'm going to take a moment to explain what that is. So there was another individual that she came to know of, and they wrote letters to each other. They might have been typed on an old-fashioned typewriter, because we're talking about the 1960s. They might have been handwritten. They were put on a piece of paper. The paper was folded up. It was put in an envelope. They sealed the envelope, wrote an address on the front, put a stamp on it, mailed it off, and it would take a week or so to get to the other person. They would do the same thing, send it back. Maybe a week or 2 weeks later, it would arrive back. Virginia Prince was a cross-dresser. She'd been a cross-dresser since she was a teenager. In the 1960s, her cross-dressing was clandestine. It was hidden. It was something that could get her arrested and put in jail. It was something that the public considered extremely shameful. It was something that you did not tell people about in public. She was writing to this other person who she believed to be a cisgender woman, and their correspondence got a little bit sexual. By today's standards, it would be considered very tame. But again, we're talking about 1961. And they wrote to each other about things they'd like to do together sexually. It was a private conversation between two individuals that was meant only for their eyes. However, the other individual was a known cross-dresser. Cross-dressing was illegal. The police were monitoring the mail, opened the mail, intercepted it, opened the mail, and both of them, including Virginia Prince, were charged with sending obscene material through the U.S. mail. So a private letter sent between two consenting adults was against the law if it said, "I want to have sex with you." And so Virginia Prince, who at that point was still living as a man, was convicted of sending obscene material through the mail and was liable to go to jail for this. Now, Virginia Prince had a PhD. She was the child of a well-known doctor. She was white. She had a successful business. She had everything going for her. And she was able to buy herself a good lawyer And the lawyer knew that Virginia Prince had been a cross-dresser all of her life and that she would continue to cross-dress, and cross-dressing at that time was illegal. So if she was caught cross-dressing, that would be a probation violation and she would go to jail. The lawyer negotiated with the judge to get her permission to cross-dress in public for educational purposes. And this was the beginning of her career as a public speaker on behalf of transvestites. And she went around to churches and service clubs and all sorts of public places dressed as a woman and spoke on behalf of transvestites and said, we're just regular people who happen to like to dress this way. We're not hurting anybody and we should have acceptance. So that's what I mean by she accidentally became the public face of cross-dressing in the US. Now, a few years later, she decided to go full-time and live as a woman for the remainder of her life. And at the time, the only words available that were trans kind of words were transvestite, which meant a man who dressed as a woman on a part-time basis, or a transsexual, who meant somebody who wanted to completely change from one binary gender to the other binary gender and make use of all the medical procedures that were available. Virginia wanted to live full-time as a woman. She wanted to use some medical procedures, but not all of them. She says, there's no word for me. I'm going to make up a word. So she made up the word transgenderist because she said she was not changing her sex. She was only changing her gender. And that, by most accounts, is the source of the word transgender that we use today. Now, Virginia, who I did know, did not like that we use the word transgender the way we do today, because to her, it had a very precise meaning. And the way we use it today is very broad and is an umbrella term that covers a quite great range of gender expressions. She felt it should just be one particular type of gender expression. But that is, by most accounts, there is always debate, there's debate about everything, but by most accounts, that is the source of the word transgender. In 1960, she started a magazine called Transvestia. You'll see two copies of it on the screen now. The 1961 is smaller on purpose. It's not just so it'll fit on the screen. The original Transvestia magazine was a little bit bigger than my cell phone, so that you could fit it in your pocket and make it disappear. Because in 1960, it was against the law and very dangerous to be known to be a transvestite. Later, it got bigger and still bigger later on as things became a little bit safer to be a transvestite. It ran for 111 issues from 1960 to 1986. Not only do we have all of those issues in our transgender archives, but they have all been digitized and they are available for you to read online if you would like to. Every word. I'd like to tell you a little bit about Reed Erickson. One of my favorite figures in all of this. I've been uncovering the story of his life and his biography for a number of years now. He's roughly contemporary to Virginia Prince. I began researching his life in 1996. At that point, he was basically unknown, except to a few people who had been his contemporaries. He was dead by the time I started researching his life. His adult daughter held all of the files from his life and his work. And when I started researching his life, she had very little knowledge about the important things that he had done. And I would find out more and write an article and bring it to her. And it really moved her and changed her life to understand that her father had done a great deal of good in the world. Most of what she remembered was the end of his life. And at the end of his life, he had taken too many drugs and was not in good shape and was not a very nice person. So it made a big difference to her that I told his story. So our relationship became stronger as a result of that. And in 2007, she was ready to donate all of his papers to an archives, and she asked me for options, and I gave her a whole list of places she could send them, but she chose UVic because we had the trust, we had the caring relationship, and I had helped her to understand. this is what she said at the time. She says, I can't tell you how thrilled I am to be able to do this. I also wanted to express how much I appreciate your interest in my father. You have been vital in uncovering his life and sharing it with others. I am incredibly thankful to you for all your hard work and interest. And I put this quote up here, not because I need the attention, but because I want you to understand that these kinds of relationships are what make people willing to part with materials that are precious to them, is because they feel that they will be cared for properly, they will be appreciated properly. So who was Reed Erickson? He started something called the Erickson Educational Foundation. He inherited a certain amount of money from his family. He was a trans man. And then he was very good at business. And he was also very lucky in that he bought some property in the US South that had oil on it. And so he made a lot of money in oil. He founded and funded the Erickson Educational Foundation, which ran for 20 years from 1964 to 1984. Its mission was to provide assistance and support in areas where human potential was limited by adverse physical, mental, or social conditions, or where the scope of the research was too new, too controversial, or too imaginative to receive traditional oriented support. He had a real knack for choosing people and organizations that were small, just getting started, giving them seed money, and picking the ones that would, under the benefit of a little bit of startup funds, become very successful and very important. So one of the places that he put money at the very beginning was an organization called One Inc. They called themselves a homophile organization. This was before we started using the word gay, and homophile was homosexuals, love of homosexuals. And so this organization was a small organization that he supported with a significant amount of money over a period of about 20 years. And that organization grew and grew. It would have died if he had not stepped in when he did, but it grew and grew. And today it lives on in the form of the One Archives at the University of Southern California in Los Angeles. The One Archives claims, and I think correctly, that they are the largest LGBTQ archives in the world. And so that would never have happened if he hadn't supported them when they were very small and somewhat desperately in need of funding organization. And so this was one of an example of him recognizing where to put some support that would really make a difference. The main area that he worked, or the Erickson Educational Foundation worked, was in support of transsexualism. I've mentioned the WPATH several times already, the World Professional Association for Transgender Health. It actually started as a result of the work of the Erickson Educational Foundation. So the Erickson Educational Foundation brought together the very small number of researchers who are working in this field in 1969 in London. They brought them together in London, England, 1971 in Dubrovnik, and 1973 in Copenhagen. And hardly anybody's working in the field, but he brought them together. He sponsored these international conferences and allowed the synergies to happen that needed to happen. And when he said, okay, well, I just do seed money, I'm not going to support these conferences anymore, they formed the precursor to the WPATH, which was then called the Harry Benjamin International Gender Dysphoria Association. And you may remember the Harry Benjamin name from an earlier slide. He wrote the first book on transsexualism. So they named the organization for Harry Benjamin. Eventually, later, they changed the name into WPATH. So again, he saw a need. He put some money into the right place, and it kept going. Pretty much all of the early researchers in the field of transgender studies were funded by Erickson. He also funded a whole series of very good publications, produced films on the subject, produced TV shows, radio shows, had a speakers bureau. There was also a hotline and a phone line. That's a phone line you could write. You could stop by the office if you happened to be in the area where he had an office. And there was a list of doctors and lawyers and other kinds of people that would give support to trans people. Very hard information to find at the time. This is long before the internet was even thought of. And finding this kind of information, who would actually help trans people in the 1960s, the 1970s, the 1980s, very difficult. But his organization pulled it all together, made it available to people. He also supported many of the early activist organizations that were just getting off the ground. And he was there to support all of them. So a huge influence in that field. Almost anything that happened in the 1970s and 80s that had to do with trans people, Erickson Educational Foundation gave it some kind of support. Later on, he became interested in New Age movements. I'll just mention a couple of them. We now take for granted that dolphins and whales communicate. He funded the first research that established that fact. And you may be aware of A Course in Miracles. It's been translated into many languages around the world. He published the first edition of the Course in Miracles. Right? So those are a couple of the other ways that he was very influential. I could go on about him for a long time because I know really a lot about him, but that's enough of an introduction to him. Okay, next big collection I want to say a few words about is the University of Ulster Transgender Archives. This was donated to us. It was collected by Richard Eakins, who you see on your screen. He started it in 1986 and collected for many years. And it was the first collection of this kind at a university. It was originally called Transgender Archives, spelled a little differently. And then 2000, he changed the name to Transgender Archives, spelled the way it is now. In 2010, he retired from the University of Ulster and took the collection with him. He had never given it to the University of Ulster. He'd simply housed it there. And when he was no longer there, they didn't want it to be there and he didn't want it to be there. So he took it to his sheep farm and put it in a climate controlled trailer that he had on the farm and kept it there for a little while. And then he said, okay, I need to find a home for it. He offered it to the London School of Economics. They have a LGBTQ archive called the Hall Carpenter Archive. And they put too many demands on him about what they would take, what they wouldn't take. They wanted him to make an inventory. He said, I'm retired. I'm not making an inventory. And because I had known him for a long time, again, those relationships, he had heard about our transgender archives and he approached me and he said, would you like our archives? I had no idea what he had. I said, I don't care. Fine, I'll take it. No conditions, no questions asked. And so by 2013, we had acquired the University of Ulster Transgender Archives. It almost doubled our collection. So that was a very big acquisition. Ayanna Marical, unfortunately, died too young. I said before that she was an Indigenous person, so she's Haudenosaunee, which is from Ontario in the center of Canada. Two-spirit, I don't know if this is a term that you're familiar with. It's a Canadian term, and it references Indigenous people who are anywhere on the LGBTQ spectrum and who are two-spirit as in having the a spirit that comes with two genders, and it could be mixed in any different kind of way. It's quite a broad term. And so she was an artist, a scholar, an educator, story crafter and storyteller. She was a performance artist and as an educator and writer. And she was looking to merge Indigenous art and culture into a Eurocentric worldview and to kind of bring the two together to learn from each other. Now, I mentioned before just briefly that I sponsor conferences called Moving Trans History Forward conferences. And at those conferences, we have a panel of elders, trans elders who speak about their perspective as elders. And I invited her to come to speak at the 2016 conference. Unfortunately, she was quite ill and she was unable to travel or to participate and actually died a few weeks later. But she did bequeath her archives to the Transgender Archives, and that was about 20 boxes, so it's a good size archives. It's full of fascinating materials from her performance and her writings and her diaries, and it's one of our most popular collections. A lot of people come to study what it is that she left for us. On this slide, just another little view of just a couple of the things that are in the archives that come from some books from different parts of the world and different kinds of images, just to give you a feeling for a few of the other items. We are, as I've mentioned a few times, quite international. Pretty much everything's in English, but not everything is in English. You can see some Japanese here. There's some Spanish. There's a few other languages. We have actually quite a large collection in Swedish. Whole other story about how that happened. And the people come from all over the world to make use of our Transgender Archives. I've just put a few up here on the screen to give you a feeling. We've had more than 50 people come from other parts of the country and other parts of the world over the last 5 years to study in our Transgender Archives. And so you can see people come from many of the universities are in Canada, but also Sri Lanka, Thammasat University in Bangkok, that scholar is actually here right now. Sachi Saruta from Chiba University in Tokyo, she's actually here right now. You saw Anna Klonkowska in the video from Gdansk, Poland. So lots of different places. Wei Dan was here for a year from Nanchang University in China. So it's a long list. This is just a few of them, but just to give you a feeling for it. And then I would like you to know that we have what we call a discovery tool, which you can use online to search some of our collections. So this is our newsletters collection. And you can see on your screen that we have so far entered information from 92 publications, 771 issues. And we have entered information from over 5,000 articles within those publications. And we also make note of events that have happened. We're building this all the time. It's a large database and it's getting larger all the time. It's by no means everything that we have, but it is a way to see a little bit more of what we have. If you go to our website, there are finding aids for the major collections that you can download and have a look at. And I will mention that we are partners with someone called the Digital Transgender Archive. And the Digital Transgender Archive is a hub. They don't own any materials in our archives. You can come and actually put your hands on the history. This is physical material objects. Digital Transgender Archives does not own any objects. In fact, they often send their objects to us if someone tries to give them to them. But what they do have, which is fantastic, is they are partners with something like 60 different archives around the world who have digitized some portion of their collection. And so a particular archive may only have digitized two or three things, or they may have digitized quite a lot. Everything that we've digitized, you can see through them or through us. But they point to archives all over the world. And so if it's been digitized somewhere in the world, you can have a look at it through the Digital Transgender Archive. So I recommend that is a great resource for people who can't travel across that great Pacific Ocean to come to our archives in person. And then finally, we're very active on social media. These are our coordinates for social media. We do have web pages, and we also have Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and a mailing list that you're invited to join. And I will just put a plug in for our YouTube channel. We have a lot of material on the YouTube channel, pretty much all of our speakers, all of our events, videos from the conferences. So I recommend you take a little time. And I think once you get in there, as often happens with YouTube, the next one looks interesting, the next one looks interesting, and you never get out of there. But I recommend our YouTube channel. Okay, thank you for your attention. I think there's a few minutes left, and nobody interrupted me with any questions, but if you would like to I'm available for a little bit of Q&A right now.
Yes. Taking that cue, we'd like to ask those who have questions to, again, raise their hand or put it to be recognized, or put your question in the chat box. You can also mute yourself when you have questions.
Yeah, it's a small group. Unmute is fine.
Yeah. I actually have one question. In most cases, the materials in the archives are used for either exhibitions or other publications. So have there been such in, apart from that you mentioned?
Yes, we have been approached by a number of exhibitions, and we have loaned materials to art institutions in several different places around North America. Generally, if we loan materials to an exhibition, it is duplicates. So if we only have one copy of something, we are reluctant to ship it off anywhere. But there's a lot of materials that we have duplicates of. And so we do loan materials, and it's not uncommon at all for people to ask for reproduction rights for materials that we have in the archives. So there are publications in that way. And of course, our visitors write things on the basis of what they do here. Just earlier today, we had a talk by Cyrus Marcus Ware, who you did see in the video, a young Black man. And he's a brilliant artist, just a brilliant artist. And he came to the Transgender Archives and made use of images in the archives as the inspiration for some of his artwork. He does just gorgeous pencil drawings that are life-size or larger than life-size, and so expressive and beautiful. And he did a talk earlier today specifically about how his work in the Transgender Archives inspired his art. And so we get a lot of people interested in making use of our materials.
Thank you. Other questions from the audience?
I have a question.
Yes.
How active are your team of researchers? Because I think there's a really big transgender community when it comes to Southeast Asia. Do you have a chance to, you know, travel to these places? I mean, before the pandemic, of course.
Yeah. That the pandemic is a big issue. I was invited to come to Thailand to talk and to work with folks there, and that had to get canceled because of the pandemic. But I have spent some time in China and made some connections with people in China who do this work. I mentioned on an earlier screen, Wei Dan was here for a year, but actually long before that, I was in China making connections. They told me at one of my first lecture in China that it was in fact the first public lecture done on transgender issues in China. That was, I think it was 2008, it might've been 2006. So I've been there several times. So China is the main place in Asia, not Southeast Asia, but in Asia, that I have made some connections, and I've continued to have connections there in the subsequent years, and know quite a few people in China who work in this area. My main connection is in Southeast Asia is Thammasat University, and they've come here and a couple of times now, the people I know from there, and I have not been able to go there, although I have been invited, but the pandemic has stopped me from going so far.
There's a question from Chi Lu. Is there any policy in terms of weeding of materials, especially those that are worn out, or does it just undergo preservation process and the materials return back to the shelves?
So far, we haven't had anything actually wear out, and we've been pretty careful with material that we think is fragile. It doesn't really get a lot of handling. We do bring things out. So for instance, today we brought out some of Ayanna Marichal's materials that we thought were fairly fragile, and we insisted that they couldn't be touched unless people were wearing latex gloves. We don't generally have a white gloves policy, which many archives do. We do let people usually touch our materials. They're not that fragile, but then we have some video material, for instance, that is quite old, and we have not been allowing people to play it because we're concerned that it will fall apart. And so we're now, right now, have just applied for a grant that we hope to be successful to pay to have it digitized so that it will be handled by people who really know what they're doing once, digitize it, and then the actual magnetic tape, which is liable to deteriorate over time, will be put away again, but we'll have the digital copies that we can make available to the public. But sometimes you just have to preserve something so that it does not wear out. But we haven't had a problem with the items that we've made available to the public. We haven't had a problem with those wearing out yet. It probably will happen one day. So I see there's a question in the chat.
Yeah, there's a follow-up question, I think.
Okay,
Marianne,
so what are the challenges? So a team of conservators that help preserve the material. You know, the Transgender Archives belong to the University of Victoria, and there is an archival team. That team works on a number of different archives. This is not the only archives. It is the largest one after the university's own collections about the history of the university, but they do have to spread themselves out. And there isn't anybody in there whose job is called conservator. They all have some sense and a good respect for how to maintain the materials, but if materials need to be handled in a special way, we send those out to experts. So as I was saying, we have this VHS tapes and audio tapes that we're concerned, and some Betamax tapes, so various kinds of magnetic tape material that we're concerned that if we play them, they'll fall apart. So we don't play them, and we will send them out to experts who know how to play them without destroying them. We don't have that skill set among our people.
Yeah, you spoke of a team. Like, how many are you in the archives, Transgender Archives?
Well, as I say, the Transgender Archives doesn't have its own staff. So the staff that take care of the Transgender Archives are also taking care of about 15 or 20 other archives, many of which are very small. And that staff is, I think it's about 6 or 7 people. It's not a big staff. Now I have a position called the chair in transgender studies, and we have a small staff, but it's very small here as well. So there's myself, there's one full-time individual and one part-time individual, and then we have students who come and go for various lengths of time and are part-time helpers. But we have a permanent full-time and a permanent part-time person in addition to myself. And we do work in a lot of work in support of the Transgender Archive. So I do pretty much all the acquisition work, all the dealing with the public, all these kinds of public talks, all the educational work that publicizes the fundraising, because we have to bring in some money to help pay for some of this. So there's a lot of social media that's all run through my office, not through the archival staff. The archival staff take care of the material and manage the material and catalog the material and make sure that all of the library end of things is done properly. But all the public outreach, outward facing work of bringing in the collections, stewarding the donors, raising money, publicizing the collections, taking care of visitors, all that work is done through the chair in transgender studies. And as I said, there's myself, one full-time person, one part-time person. And I am not full-time as the chair in transgender studies either. I also teach classes and I have a research career and many other things that I do in addition to the part that I devote to the archives.
There's a question from Chris. I think, Chris, if I'm not mistaken, this is in the context in some cases of very conservative religious folks who would have objections to transgender. So you're talking about how the archives deal with this?
Okay, good question, Chris. And this is where the cultural context is important. Canada is a very liberal country, and it is not a terribly religious country. And then British Columbia, the portion of the country I live, the state or province of the country that I live in, that the Transgender Archives is in, is the least religious portion of the country and the most liberal portion of the country. And Victoria, on top of that, is still more liberal and less religious. And so far, we've had no pushback from conservative religious people, no vocal objection. I'm sure there are people who are offended by the existence of a transgender archives and a chair in transgender studies, but the social climate is such that they do not come forward and speak to us about it. So there's been almost no objection to the work we do that I've become aware of. I would not say absolutely zero, but I could count the instances where I am aware of anyone objecting to our work on a moral grounds. I could count them on one hand, and I wouldn't use up my whole hand.
Thank you very much for that response. You also—
We're very lucky here, I can tell you.
Yeah, I think this is also one reason why we're discussing this archives in our context, also to learn how to go about doing that and how to navigate, especially as there would be interest in having such an archive in the Philippines. And
so part of what I was trying to get across in my talk that I'll just say in slightly different words now, is that there was a lot of groundwork that I did before starting the archives. Now, I didn't do it with in mind that I was preparing for starting an archives. I did it because my research career and my interest were in this area, and I was involved with organizations, and I was educating people around me about the research I was doing, which predated by a couple of decades the opening of the archives. But that meant that I had a fertile ground to work when the time came. People already had given some thought and were somewhat sympathetic to the whole idea of transgender rights, because they had been hearing from me and through me about transgender topics in this vicinity, here at the university, here in Victoria, here in British Columbia, here in Canada, and many others have been doing the same thing at the same time. So, building those relationships, building the groundwork was happening from the work I did and the work that many other people were doing at this simultaneously. So, I couldn't just drop in and say, let's start something brand new, and we've never talked about it before. Their conversation and discussion and thinking had gone on for quite some time before the Transgender Archives started. But even at that, I had that conversation with Ricky Swin, and I went to the librarian, who I did know and I had a relationship with and a good relationship with, and I said, I just asked for this collection. I hope that's okay. I was taking a risk, and I didn't know what the answer would be, but because we had a relationship, I figured probably she'd say that it was a good idea. And she went along with it. She did have to take a deep breath before she said yes.
Are there other questions or comments? Yeah. What is the greatest challenge in terms of collection management? This is from Chilu also, in terms of
The biggest challenge from my perspective is time. And what I mean by that is that there's not enough staff to ingest the collections, process the collections, and get them back out to the public in the time frame that I would like to see it happen. And so it can take 2 or 3 years for between a collection coming to us at the library and it becoming available to the public. And that's simply a matter of staff time. So he said it's not a big staff. They have to manage a number of different archives. One of the things that is a dream of mine is to have an archivist that is devoted strictly to the transgender archives. So at the moment, I would say that's probably the biggest challenge is simply staff time. If I'm allowed to continue to dream, what I would like is my own space for the transgender archives. So archives, as I'm sure you all know, are items in storage. It's not a library. They're not sitting out on a shelf where people can browse. And I would love to have a dedicated space where we could display the materials that we have and make them easily available to people. Now, our archives, and Cyrus said this in the video, is fast. And Anna Klonkowska said, and we're friendly and we're easy. And compared to many archives, it is a very easy, accessible archives. You come into our reading room, you ask for something, you've got it in 10 or 15 minutes. Now you go to the Kinsey Institute, which is the biggest sexuality archive in the world, you have to put in your order the day before. And if you see something when you're there and you say, I'd like to follow up and I'd like to see the next box, they say, come back tomorrow. We need a day's notice, right? So we have things ready in 10 or 15 minutes. And that's wonderful, but it's all in the back. It's all stored away. It comes out in boxes. And I'd love to have a dedicated space where we could take the trophies and the t-shirts and the artwork and have them all on display. And the books could be on a shelf that you could browse. But that's a dream. I don't know when I'll ever have that kind of space. Right now, the biggest challenge is just the turnaround time that it takes to get something in and get it out again. And as I mentioned before, the gaps in the archives, there's whole segments of the population that we have no archives from. And in many cases, that's because the material doesn't exist because of the kinds of circumstances I mentioned before. But some of it does exist, and I'd love to see more of that come into our archives.
Other questions or comments from the audience?
I have a question. Yes. I'm James from Memorial Commission. It's a government agency tasked to build a museum, library, and archives for Martial Law victims in the Philippines. So we're also starting to build our collection as of now. And my question is with regards with acquisition. You mentioned earlier before your strategy with acquiring collections. My question is, how do you maintain relationships with the people or institutions after acquiring the collection? And how do you make them feel that you're not just after their collection or whatever? How do you maintain that relationship with them?
Good question. As I mentioned before, the biggest collections came to us from people who already had a relationship with and had, in many cases, a long relationship with. And so we simply continue on pretty much the same basis that the relationships were before they donated the collection. So we stay in touch, we talk, we share little tidbits. Oh, you might be interested in this. It's mostly via email or Zoom. So those relationships simply were there before and they continue afterwards on no stronger or weaker basis than they were before they donated. Now, there are people who get in touch with us who I've never known before and say, would you be interested in this collection? And, you know, my attitude is to treat them as friends and to talk to them as peers and friends. And so I try to have a Zoom call or a phone call, depending on what their comfort level is, or maybe it stays on email. It usually starts on email. But I try and make some kind of personal contact with anyone who is interested in donating to the archives. And then I learn a little bit about what their interests are and who they are in the world, and try and keep in touch with them to the extent that I see things that I think they might be interested in. And so I'll send someone a little note and say, oh, I thought you might like this. So there's that personal touch. And then in between, they all go on our mailing list, and we send out newsletters, usually every few weeks. It's not on a strict schedule. Every 2 to 3 weeks, we try not to send out a newsletter unless we have something to say. We try not to abuse people's inboxes. And so that's a way to stay connected as well. So they're hearing from us. That's not so personal. The personal stuff can be many months in between a personal contact and the next personal contact. But there's always a little, there's always these little points of contact. If they're on social media, they're hearing from us through the social media as well. And so we try and maintain that as much as possible. Occasionally somebody says, I'm done now. I don't want to hear about this anymore. I gave it to you because I want it out of my life. So stop writing to me. That does happen occasionally. But most of them are very happy to continue to get the newsletters and to hear from us on social media if they're on social media. It's a personal thing. As I said in the formal part of my talk, you have to have relationships with people, and they have to feel like you care about them and you care about what they've given you. So a question here, who can access your collection in terms of age? I mean, how old do you have to be to use our collection? There's no age limit. So anybody can access the collection online, the parts of it that are online, and anybody who can come in the door of the archives reading room is eligible to access the collections. Have you encountered to collect or receive documents from donors that contain personal problems, issues, and scandals? And how would you preserve it? And how would you open it to public readers? Very good question. So one of the issues that is an ongoing issue that we're always thinking about, which is not exactly what your question is, but is related, is we have a lot of content that when it was created, the expectation, the reasonable expectation of the creator was that it would not be seen very widely. Some of it is very personal material that they never expected anybody else to see, but then it gets donated to us either by them or they've died and one of their, the executor of their estate or somebody who's caring for their materials will donate it. But there's also a lot of publications where they gave permission for something to be in a publication. There are videos where they gave permission for their image to be in a video, but that was in the 60s or the 70s or the 80s or the 90s. And the internet hadn't really taken off yet. And so their expectation when they gave the permission was that it would be a small number of people who would see this material. Those people would be people who were a similar kind of transgender to themselves, and therefore they had the reasonable expectation that their identity would be respected, it would be held in a reasonable level of confidence. And now we're looking at people who want to know their history and want to have access to those materials, and we have to ask ourselves, is it reasonable to put them up on the internet? Is it reasonable to say this person gave permission for publication, but they never imagined the level of access that the internet would allow? And so this is something we always have to spend some time thinking about. And sometimes what we do is redact portions of materials because we think it's too much personal information and we shouldn't put it up in public, even though the person gave permission for it to be published in the first place. But we feel the understanding of what publishing meant at the time that they gave that permission is quite different from what it means to publish it on the internet. So, and there's some things that we say, this is available for researchers who will sign an agreement that says they will not disclose anybody's personal information. They will not disclose the names of the individuals. They will not disclose the faces and identify anybody publicly. They can look at this video. They can look at these letters. They can look at this publication, and they can write about it in their research in a way that does not identify any of the individuals involved, but they have to sign a research agreement before we give them access. There are other things that are just open to the public. Anybody can see it, no problem, no specific questions asked. So there's different levels of access that we have to think about when we're trying to be responsible about people's privacy.
That's a really important point. And I was also going to ask, for example, you have most of your materials are given to you, and but some are, like, I can imagine here in the Philippines, some of the challenges of getting such materials to be collected, because in the first place, it might not be available because of self-preservation. They have actually destroyed it. So I like that you're very proactive in actually protecting the person who had donated that collection to you.
So one of the things that we hand out at our conferences are stickers. They're about so big, and they say, they have our logo on it, and it says, "Do not destroy." It says, "This is not junk. Do not destroy." Call the Transgender Archives, and it also gives our email address. And we hand these out to people to put on their boxes and file folders of things that they are preserving at home and have not yet decided that they want to donate it to an archives because of whatever reason. They may still just feel valuable to them. They may be still collecting. It may be something that is sentimental value and they want to keep it around, whatever the reason is. But the concern is that if something happens to them, somebody else will then be responsible for the content of those boxes and file folders. And that somebody else may look at it and think, nobody else is interested in this junk, and throw it out. I know this has happened. This happened many times. Or somebody else may say, I don't want the world to know that grandpa was a cross-dresser, and they're ashamed and they're embarrassed. And so again, they will destroy it or throw it away. Now, having a sticker on it doesn't necessarily mean that they're not going to do it anyway, but it's more likely for them to think, oh, well, maybe somebody is interested in this stuff, and okay, I'll call the Transgender Archives. So that's one of the things we do to try and save some of the more delicate materials from disappearing. I'm not sure if that's exactly what your question was, but if I wandered off too much, ask me the part that I didn't cover.
That actually answers it. I like the strategy that you have, that you actually give away those stickers. So it's not, I suppose, for the librarians here also who are listening, that's a really good strategy to give people time to think also, well, you know, and then it's also up to the archives whether or not they'll be, and how they will treat these materials in light of their mission, vision, and their commitment to the work.
And sometimes people donate things to us and we look at them and we think it's junk. So for instance, a lot of times people will say to me, well, I want to donate things to you, but I have to go through it and organize it before I give it to you. And when they say that to me, I usually say, don't bother, because I know that if that's what they're going to do, it's going to be years and maybe I'll never see it, because they'll never get around to going through all those boxes and organizing it and cleaning it out. I say, look, we've got archivists, that's our job. You send it to us, we'll take out the junk. And so people send us things, and sometimes there are shopping lists in there and receipts for a pair of shoes that they bought. And that is junk. That's not stuff we need to preserve. And that's what they meant by give me a chance to clean it out, because they know that things like that are all thrown into the same box with some things that are important. So I usually say to them, just send it to us. We'll sort it out. Don't worry about it, because we'll take those things out and we'll keep the stuff that's important.
Chris, you're raising your hand.
I would like to ask, I'm just curious, what does it mean to emphasize in your name, Aaron, he or him after your name? What does it mean?
So this is very common in North America now. There are more and more non-binary people, and they have to tell everyone about what pronouns they want other people to use referring to them. They have to say, my pronouns are they or them. There's a lot of trans people whose identity is not really obvious to other people. So someone who may identify as a man, but other people look at them and they think they're seeing a woman. And so it's becoming more common. It's mostly among university types and people who are politically active, but it's becoming more common for people to announce when you meet someone or you start a meeting, my name is and my pronouns are. And so a lot of people now put them on their Zoom titles as well as a matter of respect, so that the people who need to tell you what their pronouns are not the only ones who are doing that. So everybody does it now, not everybody, but it's becoming more common for everybody to do it. I don't think anybody would have any trouble knowing that my pronouns are he and him, but it's a matter of respect and politeness so that the people who do need to tell you, because it would not be obvious, are not singled out and are not the only ones who are saying that. And if everybody's doing it, then they do it too, and they don't have to draw special attention and unpleasant attention to themselves. So that's why I do it.
Are there other questions or comments from the audience? If there are none, I would like to thank Dr. Devor for this very interesting talk on the archives. And I'm now very much interested to do more research now that we've learned the accessibility of your archives. And thank you also for giving us some of the strategies to begin developing an archives. And primarily looking at it also as a form of caring, as you have said, establishing relationship. So this is first and foremost with the people and then the materials that they give you. Thank you very much and good evening. And I'm sure for those of you who have more questions for Dr. Devor, you can find him in the University of Victoria. He has his office, the chair in transgender studies. Again, good evening and thank you very much.
And thank you for your attention. It's a pleasure to meet you all.
Thank you very much.
Goodbye.
Bye.